Hey, how are you doing? Stay here. Yeah. Dear ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my presentation. My name is Fatih Bülbül, and I'm working at the University of Siegen in Germany. Yeah, the title was called already. The research project will be edited in collaboration with the Technische Universität of Dresden and the University of Kassel. First of all, I want to give a short overview of the presentation. I will start with the motivation, then I will show the materials and the methods, then I will show the results, and at the end of my talk, I want to summarize the content and give a short outlook. Yeah. In the regime of very high cycle fatigue, that means at very low stress amplitudes, the crack initiation takes place underneath the material surface. The internal crack grow behavior is not explored sufficiently yet and takes place without contact to any atmospheric components. In order to simulate the internal crack propagation, it is necessary to perform fatigue tests in vacuum. The long crack propagation behavior in air will be investigated by my project partners. The main question is, do all the phases of crack grow occur in the regime of very high cycle fatigue? Here we can see the conventional crack grow curve with the short crack and the long crack regime. In the short crack regime, the crack propagation is highly influenced by the microstructure, so that the crack propagation fluctuates strongly. Whereas in the long crack regime, the crack propagation is stable and can be described with the Paris-Erdogan law. In this presentation, we consider the long crack propagation regime. The further question is, has the environmental condition a significant impact to the crack propagation behavior? Yeah. The fatigue experiments were performed by means of the ultrasonic fatigue testing system, what we can see here. Here we can see the control unit of the system, and here is a long-distance microscope which is connected to the computer. By magnifying this window here, we can see that the ultrasonic fatigue testing system is extended by a small vacuum chamber, which in turn is connected to a turbomolecular pump that can reach a high vacuum pressure in this chamber. Furthermore, we can see the in-situ installation. With this quartz window here and the long-distance microscope here, it is possible to detect the crack propagation in vacuum. Yeah? The light source is directly connected to the long-distance microscope. By means of interspersed sections in air, it is possible to realize alternating fatigue experiments with changing environment. That means between air and vacuum we can change. Prior to the fatigue experiments, a micronotch will be prepared in the ultrasonic specimen by means of the focus ion beam technique. At the both ends, there is a depth difference so that at very low stress amplitudes, it is also possible to initiate a crack. Yeah, the fatigue experiments were performed on the aluminium alloy 6082 in the peak age and in the overage condition. In this table, we can see the individual values for the tensile strength, the yield strength, and the Vickers hardness. Due to the different heat treatment, the secondary precipitation condition is different in the peak age and over age condition. Here we can see it for the peak age condition. We see needle-like secondary precipitates with a preferred orientation. Due to the longer heat treatment in the over age condition, the secondary precipitates are coarsened. This transmission electron microscopy images were taken at the Technische Universität Dresden. Good. Now I want to show the results. In this slide, we see the result of experiment for the aluminium alloy 682 in the peak edge condition at the constant stress amplitude of 125 megapascal. In this experiment, the environmental condition was changed between vacuum and air. Here we can see the crack path and the corresponding EBSD analysis. Crack propagation. Oh, so we can in the crack path we can find four characteristic areas named as air 1, vacuum 1, air 2, and vacuum 2. So crack propagation was started in air. What we can see after crack initiation that the crack propagated under an angle of about 45 degrees, but after a certain crack length, the crack propagated perpendicularly to the loading axis. What we can see here. Yeah? After a certain crack length, the environmental condition was changed to vacuum. What we can see now is that slip bands formed on the material surface. Furthermore, the crack propagated along an activated slip band. We go further, the environmental condition was changed to air, named S2. What we see again is that the crack propagated perpendicularly to the loading axis. Furthermore, we can see that the crack path is more fine than in vacuum. Finally, In vacuum 2, what we can see is very remarkable that the crack was deflected within the crane and that slip bands formed again on material surface which extend the crack path. The same behavior we can observe on the right side and as well as on the left side. In this slide, the available glide traces for the individual cranes were calculated. What we can see here is that after crack initiation, there is a correspondence between the crack path and the glide trace with the highest Schmidt factor. But after a certain crack length, there is no correspondence anymore. We go further to vacuum 1, we see that slip bands which form on this material surface in this direction shows a clear correspondence with the glide trace with the highest Schmidt factor. And the crack propagated along a Schmidt factor, along a glide trace with a Schmidt of a second highest Schmidt factor. On the left side, we see the same. In the subgrain here, also slip band formation in this direction, a clear correlation with the glide trace with the highest Schmidt factor. In the area R2, there is no correspondence between crack path and the calculated glide traces. But then finally, in vacuum 2, we see slip bands which formed on the material surface and extend the crack path show a clear correspondence with the glide trace with the highest Schmidt factor. Also, we can see it on the right side as well as on the left side. If you take a closer look to the crack propagation rates for the left and the right crack tip, please give attention here that the scaling bar is increasing from the right to the left. We can see that the crack propagation in air is higher, significantly higher than in vacuum, by a factor of 10 or even 100. So what we can see in this experiment is that not only the crack propagation rates are very different between air and vacuum, also the crack propagation mechanism is very different between air and vacuum for this material condition. We see in air, for the most part, normal stress control, crack propagation, whereas in vacuum we can see shear stress controlled crack propagation. Here we can see the fracture surface morphology of this experiment. By means of the contour, the individual areas were estimated here. By comparing R2 with R1, we see there is no big difference, smooth structures, but if we take a closer look to vacuum 1, park sample here, we can see that there are fracture surfaces that are very smooth and show changes in the direction. Also, in the area vacuum 2, we can find faceted structures. Yeah, the same fatigue experiment was performed for the aluminum alloy 682 in the over-age condition at a constant stress amplitude of 120 MPa. Here we can see the crack path, the ABC analysis, and the corresponding crack propagation rates. Also here, the crack propagation was started in air. What we can see is that the crack path is pronounced perpendicularly to the long axis. Then the condition was changed to vacuum 1. What we can see is that slip bands formed again on the material surface. But here, for the most part, on the right side, the crack path is pronounced perpendicularly to the long axis. On the left side as well, also here, here we have a deflection in the crack path. We go further, R2, the crack is more fine and pronounced perpendicularly to the long axis. And finally, in vacuum 2, only very locally we can find slip band formation on material surface and the crack path is pronounced perpendicularly to long axis. If you take a closer look to the crack tips and take the glide traces into the consideration, we will see that in air there is no correspondence between the calculated glide trace and the crack path. But in vacuum we see that slip bands formed, for example here in this direction, which shows a clear correspondence with the glide trace with the Heil Schmidt factor. When we go further, where the deflection was, we will see that here there is a correspondence between the crack path and the calculated glide trace with the Heil Schmidt factor. In this area, we see that slip bands formed in this direction also clear correspondence, but the crack path does not show a clear correspondence. In air, no correspondence, and finally in vacuum also we see no correspondence between the calculated glide traces and the crack path, only, for example here, slip band formation shows a correspondence with the glide trace with the Heil-Schmidt factor. On the right side, we see the same, no correspondence in air. In vacuum, we have a correspondence between the calculated glide traces and the slip band formation, but the crack path does not show a correspondence in air also, and finally, in vacuum, the same. Here we can see the fracture surface morphology of this experiment. The fracture surface is pronounced elliptical. Behind the orange line, we see the false rupture. By comparing the individual areas, we see no big difference. Only in the area vacuum, we can find deviations in the fracture surface morphology. Yeah, the following slides relate to the LME law 682 in a peak edge condition, and the experiments were performed totally in vacuum. Here we can see the crack path. What we can see is that the crack path deviates clearly to the normal direction. If you take a closer look, you will see that over the entire crack path, there is a correlation between the crack path and the calculated glide traces. If you take a closer look to the left and the right crack tip, we will see that the crack propagated unevenly. Especially on the right side, the crack was stopped completely at a crack length of 150 micrometers. If you take a closer look to this area, we will see that slip bands formed on the material surface, which was the slip band formation was impeded due to the grain boundary, leading to a parallel arrangement of slip bands on the material surface. Yeah, the unevenly crack propagation can be observed also in the fracture surface morphology, showing a non-elliptical fracture surface. If you take a closer look, park sample behind the micronotch, we will see that there are fracture surfaces that are very smooth and shows changes in the direction. Also, we can find faceted structures. Yeah, the question is there a transition of the crack propagation where the mechanism changes from stage one to stage two? To clarify this situation, a fatigue experiment were performed where the stress amplitude was stepwise increased. In this experiment, the crack propagation was started at 120 megapascal. Until 140 megapascal, the crack propagated shear stress controlled. But then, after applying a stress amplitude of between 145 to 150 megapascal, the crack path bends to the normal direction. Here we can see the crack propagation rates for the left and the right crack tip. And the right crack tip was stopped until a stress amplitude of 150 megapascal were applied. If you take a closer look to the fracture surface morphology, we see a non-elliptical fracture surface because, for the most part in this experiment, the crack, the long crack propagated shear stress controlled. But in the end, where 150 megapascal were applied, we can find fracture surfaces. They are very smooth. Furthermore, we can find a deviation like this, which is caused by a pinning effect caused by primary precipitate cluster. And this pinning effect normally just were observed at crack propagation in air by my colleagues. Yeah, to confirm this this observation, a fatigue experiment at a constant stress amplitude of 150 megapascal were performed, and we can see from the crack path that the crack path is pronounced, yeah, for the most part, perpendicular to the loading axis. Here we can see the crack propagation rate for the left and right crack tip. If you take the glide traces in consideration, we see there is, for the most part, no correlation between the calculated glide trace and the crack path. Only here, also here, we can see an area where crack branching took place. Only here we can see that the crack was deflected. Most probably here we had shear stress control crack propagation. If you take a closer look to the fracture surface morphology, we can see that the fracture surface is almost pronounced elliptical, only, and very homogeneous. Only in particular areas like here, there are deviations, faceted structures can be found, and also here, a pinning effect were found. Now I want to summarize the content. In vacuum, very pronounced single sliding takes place. This will be confirmed to the slip band formation on the material surface. The main crack propagation mechanism in 682 in a peak edge condition is shear stress controlled under very high cycle fatigue loading. So the stage one crack propagation in vacuum is therefore independent of anisotropic effects such as rolling texture and result due to the absence of air humidity. If you take a closer look to the over edge condition, we only find in particular areas shear stress controlled crack propagation, but for the most part, normal stress control crack propagation dominates. So two effects are assumed that influence the very high cycle fatigue long crack propagation behavior in vacuum. First one, there is a atmospheric influence, and second one, an influence of the secondary precipitation condition. If someone is interested in these effects, there is a source in the manuscript that can be read. Good. In air, we have higher crack propagation rates than in vacuum. This is associated with the larger reversibility of the plastic deformation in the vacuum. And at higher stress amplitudes for the aluminum alloy 682 in the peak age condition, for the most part, stage 2 crack propagation takes place. And here, primary precipitate cluster can retard the crack propagation. So if we take a closer look to the peak age condition for the entire crack path, we detected that there's a correlation between the calculated clyde traces and the crack path. So a short fatigue crack prone model based on the boundary LLM method, which was originally developed for the simulation of short cracks in high strength steel, can be applied for this material condition. From the EBSD data, the microstructural parameters can be considered, and the available clyde traces were calculated. If you take a closer look to the right image here, especially on the left side, we see that the simulated wide crack path corresponds very well with the black experimental crack path, and both cracks follow the clyde trace with the Heil-Schmidt factor. So this result show that the crack-prone model can be applied for the very high cycle fatigue long crack propagation in vacuum for this material condition, peak aged. So with this model, a physical-based assessment of the effect and relevance of microstructural parameters on the very high cycle fatigue life is possible. Because in many experiments, like this experiment previously showed, a total crack stop were detected at the crane boundary. What we can do now is to take this information, microstructure information, introduce it in the model in order to increase the fatigue lifetime or even reach the real fatigue limit in the model. Yeah? In this sense, I want to thank you very much for your kind attention and the Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft for the financial support.